Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. It's my great pleasure to welcome Ankur Tali back to MSR Redmond, and he's going to tell us all about sandboxing, untrusted JavaScript. Thank you. Take it away.
Hello.
Yeah. Hi.
So thanks, Patrice. This is a joint work with Sergio Mephis, John Mitchell, Ulfa Erlingson, Mark Miller, and Jasveer Nagra. So I'm sure all of you have used web pages that have ads, maps, or social networking applications. These are all examples of third-party content that is embedded on hosting pages today. Very often, such content comprises of executable JavaScript code that manipulates features of the hosting page, reacts to user events, asynchronously talks to the server, and provides a rich user experience. Also, often this third-party content is untrusted. So an embedding page may not trust the provider of an advertisement, or Facebook may not trust the author of a Facebook application. So this work is about studying methods for safely embedding third-party JavaScript code on hosting pages. Now let's see what goes wrong if you try to directly embed JavaScript code on a page. By directly embed, I mean you fetch the third-party JavaScript source code and append it to the code of the hosting page. And this can be done using the script source equal to tag that HTML provides. So here we have two advertisements that have been directly embedded on the page. Now, as I said, what these ads want to do is they want to decorate the page, move around, interact with the hosting page, display fancy things. And the way they can do that is by accessing the document object model of the page. Now, the document object model, or the DOM, is essentially a browser library that provides access to various elements of the page. So for example, on this page here, using the DOM, the untrusted advertisement can get access to all the form fields on the page. Now, what that means is that if this advertisement is bad, then it can read the password field from the form and then send it off to an evil location. So untrusted third-party JavaScript poses a threat to critical hosting page resources. And it's not just that. This malicious advertisement here can actually use the DOM to get hold of the other ad and then perhaps change its content or do something more malicious. And so untrusted third-party JavaScript poses a threat to other third-party components also running on the page. So now I'll state the JavaScript sandboxing problem. Before doing that, whenever I use the word sandboxing, it's in an abstract sense as a mechanism for restricting code. So the JavaScript sandboxing problem is to design a sandboxing mechanism for untrusted JavaScript in order to protect critical resources belonging to the hosting page and also critical resources belonging to other third-party components. There are three constraints that I set for myself in solving this problem. The first one is the solution should not require browser modification. This is basically for deployability reasons. This is a design choice that we make. There are solutions that can work with browser modification also, but we focus on solutions that don't require browser modification. Secondly, the solution must be backed by provable guarantees. And hopefully by the end of this talk, I'll convince you why provable guarantees are really important when dealing with JavaScript. And the third one is that our sandboxing mechanism should allow for a practically useful subset of JavaScript. Now, the way we check for this third condition is by comparing our mechanism with an existing sandboxing mechanism, which is FBJS. Now, FBJS is Facebook's mechanism for sandboxing third-party applications on Facebook profile pages. So the big oval here is the set of all possible JavaScript programs. And the smaller inner oval is the set of JavaScript programs accepted by FBJS. Now, we want to be somewhere in the middle. So we want to be no more restrictive than FBJS. The reason we pick FBJS is because there are hundreds of thousands of Facebook applications that are around there, and so it's a good indication that it's a practically useful subset of JavaScript. Okay, so now one way of solving this problem is to use the browser-based sandboxing mechanism called iframes. And here's how it works. You first load the hosting page code. Then you create an iframe and load the third-party content into this iframe. The browser guarantees that this iframe code runs in a separate execution environment. Further, since 2009, all the major browsers support the post-message API that allows for lightweight communication across frames. And since then, rich abstractions have been built on top of this API that allows for communicating objects across frame boundaries. So it looks like this idea can work, and the iframe-based mechanism can be used for solving the sandboxing problem. However, it may not be the most preferred option, and it was especially the case back in 2008 when PostMessage did not exist or was not standardized on all the major browsers. Now, one reason why iframes is not useful is because it restricts content to a confined region of the page. So if you have all those advertisements that like to bounce around the page and move around, it's difficult to do them using iframes. Secondly, iframes only give you a restricted or a separate execution environment. We have no control over what runs inside the iframe. And so iframe code may very well be exploiting browser vulnerabilities. It could be navigating the top page, causing cross-site request forgeries, etc. And finally, there is a performance penalty that you pay if you try to use PostMessage to communicate objects or libraries across frame boundaries. So the pros and cons that I've just described are sort of analogous to those of process-based isolation in operating systems. You know, you can think of iframes as processes and PostMessage as an inter-process communication channel. Now, the alternative in operating systems is language-based sandboxing. And that's exactly our approach, the one we follow in this work. So the idea is you load the hosting page code first. Then you prefetch the third-party content on the hosting page server. You statically analyze and rewrite it, and then bring this rewritten code on the hosting page. Now, your rewriting must be such that this rewritten code only has restricted interaction with the hosting page. Depending on what security policy I want to enforce between the interaction between the sandbox code and the hosting page, I will appropriately carry out the static analysis and rewriting at the server. This is the approach that's followed by Facebook FPGS for sandboxing Facebook applications on profile pages, Yahoo AdSafe for sandboxing advertisements, Google Kaha for building safe mashups, and Microsoft Web Sandbox for sanitizing active content on Hotmail. Yes?
So if you accept this analogy between iframes and processes, it seems that in practical deployment, most of the time you use processes. I mean, Chrome uses it for, you know, isolation of different tabs and plugins and things of that nature and so on and so forth. So is there a case to be made for the rewriting approach to be to have sort of long-term future?
Yeah, so one reason I think why all these mechanisms use language-based sandboxing is one, the process-based analog is too coarse-grained. So it absolutely gives you a separate execution environment. And secondly, in general, what process-based isolation can do is you can enforce policies at the system level. So if you have a policy on access to system resources, then process-based isolation is good, and that is what Chrome follows. But if you have policies that are more dependent on the application invariants, like a hosting page, for example, think of Yelp. You know, you have the Yelp page and you have Google Maps. Now, Yelp may have its own policy on its own resources, and so it wants to expose its own custom policy, and that's where these language-based techniques are more useful, because I can appropriately rewrite the third-party code to enforce my own policy. But there's a case that can be made for both, and towards the end, I'll also talk about browser-based approaches that I've developed. So there's content security policy and sandbox iframes, which sort of get rid of some of the criticisms that I made of the iframe approach. And so that line of work also works. Yes?
Could Facebook add-ins be actually implemented as iframes? I mean, in other words, they went this direction.
Yes.
But partly it was maybe because this post message didn't exist when they started. Is there any functionality that they take advantage of that wouldn't be possible with iframes?
So there is a rich API that Facebook exposes to all Facebook applications. So, for example, if you want to get hold of the friends, and this is of the friends of the current user, then there is an API that Facebook exposes. And that would be difficult to do via post message. You'll have to marshal it into strings, into JSON strings, and then communicate it. And secondly, iframes are not seamless. And so visually, you know, it sort of appears as a different box, and you can't format it as nicely as you can format direct div elements that are directly embedded into the page. And so that's one of the reasons why Facebook goes this way. Okay. So our goal is to systematically design these language-based sandboxing mechanisms. And so one question now that we might have is, what policies must be enforced? In order to answer this question, we reviewed the implementations of Facebook FPGS, Yahoo AdSafe, Google Kaha, and Web Sandbox. The reason we had to go through the implementation is because these mechanisms come with just English documentation, which is not enough to precisely understand what security goals are being enforced. So we analyzed their implementation, And we abstract out three security policies: hosting page isolation, inter-component isolation, and mediated access. In the next three slides, I'm going to go over these three policies. I'm going to define them and the associated sandboxing problems for them. So this is our language-based sandboxing setup. Now, the hosting page may have certain resources that it deems as security critical. For example, the cookie object or the location object. And it may not want sandbox code to ever have access to these resources. And this is what we call the hosting page isolation policy. So the problem is to ensure that sandbox code does not access a given set of security critical resources. Moving on, suppose we have two applications, Alice and Bob, that we have sandboxed and we have enforced the hosting page isolation policy and we have brought them on the hosting page. Now, we may have the additional goal that these two applications must be isolated from each other. So think of the two applications as advertisements. So I have a page with multiple ads and I enforce the hosting page isolation policy on them. Now, I want the ads to be isolated from each other. I don't want one ad messing with the execution of the other ad. And this is the inter-component isolation policy. So here we have this additional goal that one advertisement must not write, or one third-party component must not write to a heap location that the other third-party component can read from. Note that this second policy is weaker than non-interference. It only prevents communication via the heap. So it doesn't take care of covert channels, and so it's a weaker policy than non-interference. Now, the previous two policies are about isolation. So I can say, I can sort of say that third-party code should be completely isolated from the cookie object. However, for some resources, complete isolation may be too strong. For example, it may be fine for me to expose access to the location object to third-party code, so long as it can set it to subdomains of google.com. Right? So this is what we call the mediated access policy. And the way you enforce it is using the API plus language-based sandboxing paradigm. So the idea is you have some resources that you want to protect. You want to mediate access to these resources. So create an API that provides restricted access to these resources. This is trusted API that the hosting page creates. Then you fetch the third-party content. You statically analyze and rewrite it such that it can only access the API. So my sandbox ensures that third-party code only sees the API, and the API only provides restricted access to critical resources. Now, the security goal is that third-party code must not be able to obtain direct access to any critical resource. Or in other words, all access to critical resources must be mediated by the API. This approach is motivated by object capabilities. You can think of these API methods as basically capabilities that I'm handing over to third-party code. And also, this is a vehicle for enforcing least privilege, because my API can just expose the right amount of functionality that third-party code needs. Yes?
Does this make an assumption of what the JavaScript features you won't allow, so that you can statically analyze the JavaScript?
Yes, it does. So that is part of the solution to this problem. Right now, I'm just defining my problems that I want to solve. And that is part of the solution. And I'll go over to why, you know, restricting JavaScript is sort of important in order to solve this problem. So now there are two problems to be solved here. The first one is the sandbox design problem, which is we must design a correct sandbox. What does that mean? It should ensure that sandbox code obtains access to any protected resource only via the API. So sandbox code sees nothing but this API. The second one is the API confinement problem, which essentially means that the API itself must not leak. So no sandbox untrusted code must be able to use the API to obtain a direct reference to something that the API is trying to hide behind it. So no interleaving of the API calls should give you access to a critical resource. Now, the sandbox design problem is something that you'll solve once for a language. You know, once I have this context ready, which can take in third-party code and bind it to an API, I'm done. All the policy stuff is hidden in the API. Each time I have a new policy, I'll define a new API. And for each such new API, I have to re-establish confinement. So API confinement is fundamentally a verification problem. So that's the summary. We are interested in language-based sandboxing. And there are three policies that we care about in this work: hosting page isolation, inter-component isolation, and mediated access. Now, I don't want you to think of these three as sort of three orthogonal pieces. They are sort of in a hierarchy. So once you have hosting page isolation for one component, then you have inter-component isolation for multiple components. And once you have isolation, then you move to mediated access, which is a more richer policy. The language where we want to enforce these policies is standardized JavaScript. So JavaScript is backed by a standards body, which is the ECMA 262 committee. Back when I started this work in 2008, the ECMA standard was in its third edition. So we call JavaScript based on third edition of the standard as ES3. In December 2009, the ECMA committee released a fifth edition of the standard, which has a strict mode. So we call the strict mode JavaScript as ES5 strict. Now I'm going to use these acronyms throughout the talk. So ES3 is old JavaScript. ES5 strict is strict mode of new JavaScript. You might be wondering what happened to the fourth edition. And so it turned out that the committee was stuck on the fourth edition, and then they decided to skip it altogether. And so they jumped straight away to the fifth edition. The techniques that we use are programming language semantics, inline runtime monitoring, static analysis, and object capabilities. These are all very standard techniques. They've been used previously for designing language-based sandboxing mechanisms in the context of operating systems or the Java virtual machine, and so on. The real challenge here is in applying these techniques to JavaScript. So all the devils are in the details here. So I'll give you a quick summary of all the results that we have. So the first thing we did is we developed an operational semantics for JavaScript. This gave us a formal framework for reasoning about JavaScript programs. We used this framework to analyze the FPGAs and ad-safe sandboxing mechanisms, and we tried to prove that they correctly enforce the hosting page isolation policy. Unfortunately, the proof broke, and we found exploitable vulnerabilities in both these mechanisms. Then we developed our own solution for enforcing hosting page isolation within ES3 JavaScript. Then we analyzed the FPGAs sandboxing mechanism to prove that it correctly enforces intercomponent isolation, and the proof broke again. We found an exploitable vulnerability there. And so we developed our own solution for enforcing intercomponent isolation within ES3 JavaScript. And this solution was based on object capabilities. Now, this was around the time when ES5 strict came out. So then we developed a solution for enforcing mediated access for ES5 strict JavaScript. And as part of this work, we also developed an automatic tool that soundly establishes confinement of ES5 strict APIs. We used the tool to analyze the Yahoo AdSafe DOM API. We found an exploitable vulnerability there. We fixed the vulnerability and then proved correctness of the fixed API. You might be wondering why I did not solve the mediated access problem for ES3, and I'll get to that in the talk. But the short answer is, enforcing mediated access requires API confinement, establishing API confinement, which is a static analysis problem. And static analysis of ES3 is extremely challenging. And I'll go over the reasons for that in the talk. So the rest of this talk is going to be about these papers and those attacks. So the talk is divided into two sections. First, I'll talk about our work on enforcing hosting page isolation in ES3, and then our work on enforcing mediated access within ES5 strict. So again, the problem is to ensure that sandbox code does not access a given set of security critical resources. I'll first tell you about our operational semantics for JavaScript, then our sandboxing technique, and then I'll compare our sandboxing technique with FPGAs. So JavaScript was developed by Brendan Eich in 1995 when he was working at Netscape. It's inspired by self. It has first-class functions and hash-table-like objects. So objects are essentially records with mutable, deletable, and extensible properties. The inheritance mechanism is via prototypes. So each object has a prototype object. So if you're looking for a property in this object and you don't find it, then you go to its prototype object and then its prototype and so on. Every such prototype chain is upper bounded by certain built-in prototype objects like object.prototype or array.prototype. These are predefined prototype objects that the native JavaScript environment provides. There's the infamous eval construct. So you can take in string, and then you can eval it, so you can run it as code. And then scopes can be first-class objects in JavaScript. In particular, there's this construct called with. So you can do with a particular object and then some code, which means run this code considering this object as the current activation record. What that means is if you're looking up a variable in this code, then that variable lookup translates into a property lookup for this object. There are several peculiarities. In JavaScript, it's completely cool to add a string and an object. What it does, it fires an implicit type conversion in the background, trying to convert the object to a string so that this operation does not give an error. Unrolling of while loops is not semantics preserving. That's just a peculiar semantics of while loops. So, and these are just two peculiarities that I showed you. There are many such things. We developed an operational semantics for JavaScript. I'd like to emphasize that this semantics is for the full language. It's not a core calculus or a toy semantics. And so the process was quite challenging, in particular because of the sheer volume. We had to deal with each and every JavaScript construct. And further, JavaScript is full of surprises, as I told you, and a lot of standard techniques fail, like unrolling of while loops, for example. It doesn't apply to JavaScript. Our semantics is small step style. We do not model the DOM. It's entirely based on the third edition of the ECMA 262 spec. It's quite long, 70 pages in ASCII. It took us 6 man-months to develop this. The semantics is sort of meant for manually carrying out proofs. It's not in an automated theorem prover. As part of this process, we spotted lots of discrepancies across browsers. So we came across lots of examples where the browsers don't agree, or the browsers don't agree with the spec. We proved two basic sanity check properties. The first one is a progress theorem, that execution of well-formed terms does not get stuck. And the second one is a heap reachability theorem. So for every state, we can define the set of reachable heap locations, and then we can prove that during the execution of the state, all the heap locations that get accessed are a subset of what were reachable initially. So it's a sanity check property, and what it shows is that a basic heap reachability-based garbage collector is feasible for JavaScript. So you can't compute on heap locations in JavaScript. Recently, there's been some related work using our semantics. So folks at Imperial College London have used our semantics to formally prove soundness of a program logic for JavaScript. And then Matt Fredrickson at Wisconsin-Madison has formalized it in Prolog to prove properties of JavaScript programs. Okay, so now I'll present our solution to the sandbox design problem. So how do you ensure that sandbox code does not access a set of given set of security critical resources? So think of the security critical resources as essentially objects in the hosting pages environment. So these are some critical objects in the hosting pages environment, and we don't want third-party code to ever have access to them. So let's first construct a blacklist of global variables from which these objects are reachable. So our blacklist could have, let's say, the window, the variable name window. Can I take your question after this slide, please? From which a critical if the window object is critical, then you'll add the global variable window to this blacklist. If the document object is critical, you'll add document, and so on. So now the problem is to ensure that sandbox code does not access any global variables from this given blacklist. Yeah.
Then do you stop that kind of attack that will misuse the existing sandbox? Formulate my question again. I could provide some wrong parameters when I make an API call so that I can cause some problem.
That's the API part. That's exactly the confinement. That's exactly what the confinement problem is trying to prevent. So the confinement analysis is meant to find problems like that. So once I say that the API is confined, then I can at least say that you cannot provide any wrong parameters whatsoever in order to obtain direct reference.
Manually do the confinement? Are you
no, it's an automatic analysis of the API implementation.
Okay, So
think of, let's say, an API like jQuery. Okay, and now you want to say, can I provide malicious parameters to jQuery so that I directly get hold of a DOM object? So I analyze the implementation of jQuery in order to establish that this cannot happen.
Okay, I'll take it offline.
Sure. Okay, so we want to ensure that third-party code cannot access a set of blacklisted global variables. Now, one simple approach to do this is, you fetch the third-party code, you do a static scope analysis, figure out what global variables it's trying to access, and then discard the code if it's trying to access any of these blacklisted global variables. Because we get to see the third-party code before placing it on the page, so we can do the static scope analysis at the server, right? So let's see how you can do this for JavaScript. So here I have a global variable x. Then I have a function foo, which declares x locally. There's some code, and then it returns x. So all the code in red is, let's say, untrusted code, okay, third-party code that I get. And now we want to do a static scope analysis of this. And we ask the question, can the function foo access the global variable x? Now, in any sane lexically scoped language, you would be tempted to say no, because the variable x is declared locally. And so how can the return binding should bind, the return occurrence of x should bind to the local occurrence? Unfortunately, in JavaScript, the answer is yes. because you can delete the local occurrence of X. Okay, I say I get to see this code before placing it on the page. If you use delete, I discard the code right away. But then you can directly get hold of the global scope object using this and then read properties of it. So remember, scope objects can be first class. And using this keyword this, I can get hold of the global scope object as a first class object and then read properties of it. So these properties are essentially global variables. So now again, the X binds to the global variable X. Okay, I say I remove this from the language as well. Now you can dynamically generate this code. So now this is code that I don't even see. So I can't do a basic filtering-based approach. And then there is with and try-catch, which can come and trouble my scope analysis further. So at this point, I give up. I say, let's not do a scope analysis. Any identifier or property name that appears in the code is potentially a global variable. I'm very conservative now. So if I have the global variable eval as blacklisted, then if you use eval, be it local or global, I don't like your code. So we reformulate the problem to ensure that sandbox code does not access any identifiers or blacklist or property names that are in the blacklist. So we want a filtering and rewriting technique that can enforce this property. So our approach consists of two steps. The first step is to disallow all forms of dynamic code generation. Because if you have dynamic code generation, then that provides an escape channel from all the static analysis and rewriting that I do at the server. The second step is to filter and rewrite all identifier and property lookup mechanisms and enforce the blacklisting check on them. Okay, so how can you do dynamic code generation in JavaScript? Did you have a question?
So you're going to throw out dynamic code generation?
Yes.
So could you not just check at when the code is generated dynamically?
Yeah, you can rewrite eval and function to enforce whatever static analysis rewriting that the server was doing. You'll have to parse JavaScript on the client side, and that can get expensive and also complicated, especially with ES3. I will give you a solution with ES5 strict that allows for eval. Okay. So we will improve upon this in the next few slides. So dynamic code generation can be done using the eval operator and the function constructor. And these two are accessible using the keywords, using the variable names, eval, function, and constructor. So let's throw these into the blacklist. You're not allowed to access any of these. So then I ask, what are the various identifier and property access mechanisms in JavaScript? Now this is where the semantics comes in useful. I go over my semantics, figure out all possible ways in which you can access identifiers or property names, and come up with three channels. The first one is a standard identifier channel, so you can access identifiers by just naming them in your code. And so I filter out all terms that mention an identifier name that is blacklisted. Then properties can be accessed using the standard dot mechanism. And so I filter out all terms that have a subterm e.x where the named property x is blacklisted. The third one is dynamic property lookup, which is the tricky case. So remember, objects are hash tables in JavaScript. So you can access object properties using this array-like box operator. So I have e1 box e2, which means evaluate the expression e2 to a string and access the property name corresponding to the string. Now here, the property is being generated dynamically. So I don't see it. So a static filtering-based approach cannot work. So instead, we do a runtime check. We replace e1 box e2 with e1 idx of e2, where idx is a blacklisting check that says, if e2 returns anything that is a blacklisted string, then I will return null. Otherwise, I'll behave as the identity function. So idx is just a blacklisting check on e2. Facebook uses an exactly similar rewriting mechanism, and the name IDX actually comes from there. So we thought, let's try to analyze the Facebook IDX mechanism. Let's try to prove that it's correct, and then reuse that in our sandboxing mechanism. So we did that, and in fact, we found an attack on the Facebook IDX function. So in order to understand this attack, let's see how this IDX works. The first step is you evaluate the argument, then you convert it to a string. If the string is blacklisted, then you return bad. Otherwise, you return whatever you evaluated on step one. Now, there is a time of check to time of use attack here. I can pass an object that returns a different string on subsequent string conversions. So now, how do you convert an object to a string in JavaScript? You do that by calling its toString method. So the trick is, let's create an object that has a toString method that redefines itself each time it is called. So the first time it returns foo, but then also redefines itself to return eval on the next time. And so defining even a simple check function is tricky in JavaScript. here is our solution for IDX. It's a bit complicated, but I'll walk you through it. The first step is, let's blacklist all variables that begin with the letter dollar. So this is a namespace of variables, and this is our trusted namespace, which is our scratch space for the runtime checks. So our runtime monitor needs to do some bookkeeping in this space. So we don't want untrusted code to ever write to it. So let's throw this entire namespace into the blacklist. Then we initialize certain global variables, certain dollar variables. So we initialize the string constructor in a dollar variable, and then we initialize the blacklist in a dollar variable. Then our IDX rewriting essentially involves, first evaluate the argument expression into a dollar variable, and then return an object that has a toString method that first converts this dollar value to a string and then enforces a blacklisting check on it. Now this is fairly complicated, and the reason it's complicated is it's correct, and it has the additional property that it's semantics preserving for good code. What does that mean? If you have E1 box E2 and E2 does not evaluate to anything blacklisted, then this rewriting does not alter the meaning of code. Okay, so now we have our...
Is it fair to say that you're doing JavaScript inline reference monitoring?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yeah. This is exactly inline reference monitoring. Yeah. The IDX is a reference monitor.
That'd be very interesting. Maybe we should take this offline.
Yes.
It'd be very interesting your thoughts about how we did inline reference monitoring in the browser shield.
This approach, these ideas are all motivated, as I said, we reviewed the implementation of all these things in the beginning, and all these ideas are sort of motivated from there. So our goal initially was to prove correctness of things like Browser Shield and FPJS and AdSafe, but these were massive implementations, and so we sort of abstracted out the main checks or these reference monitors that they are enforcing. We created this model, and we tried to prove correctness of this model. So we define these filtering and rewriting mechanisms. Now we are ready to prove our theorem. So in order to set this theorem, we define JSafe of the blacklist as ES3 with the identifier and dot filters applied. So it is a sublanguage of ES3 that does not allow blacklisted identify names, and it does not allow blacklisted property names to be named. We define a source-to-source rewriting on JSafe using this IDX rewriting mechanism, and then let H be the heap obtained by running the IDX initialization code. So the theorem that we prove is that for all terms in the language JSafe, the rewritten term, when executed on the heap H, does not access any identifier or property name that is blacklisted. This theorem is proved by an induction on the set of reduction rules in the semantics. And now, with this theorem, we successfully enforce hosting page isolation, because we can ensure that you don't access any blacklisted identifier and property name. In our papers, we also have a mechanism for isolating the global scope object and a semantics-preserving rewriting technique for identifiers. Okay, so now let's go ahead and compare our technique with FPGS.
Just a quick question. So you said you didn't model the DOM in the operational semantics?
Yes.
So are there attacks through the DOM that you can't reason about because they occur?
Yeah, so we have a worst-case model for the DOM. So the DOM is this one blob where everything points internally. So all DOM references point to the DOM object, and the DOM object is considered critical.
Okay.
So in fact, we have a huge number of false positives coming from there.
So the DOM is also another way of injecting code. Do you model that as well?
No, yes. So that's where it gets unsound. So for example, are you referring to document.write and things like that? Yeah. So if you have a precise model for the DOM, then you can sort of repeat the same analysis and add, let's say, the write property to the blacklist. And so you can't access, it's part of this dynamic code generation step. So the overall steps are the same. If you want to handle the DOM, then you can also analyze the DOM model and sort of figure out what are the ways of doing dynamic code generation, throw them to the blacklist. What are the ways of accessing properties and identify names that the DOM provides and enforce a blacklisting check on them? But I totally understand that the DOM model, the lack of a specification of the DOM is critical to soundly do this for any existing browser implementation. It's a point I will refer to towards the end of my talk.
So is the blacklist related to the API compiling part first?
It is typically, but this work, we just look at the blacklist abstractly. But the reason all these implementations have a blacklist is because they want to forbid access to certain things that the API is using for bookkeeping. and certain critical objects. Like Facebook has an object called Facebook Library that it has internally, and you don't want, and so the string Facebook Library is blacklisted.
So you're sure the blacklist is complete, are you going to talk about that in the API confinement part?
Am I going to talk about the API confinement part?
So is that the same problem, basically, the blacklist? So I guess my question is, what if your blacklist is not complete? Then that somehow allows you to access some critical resources. That's basically
Right. So when I do the API confinement work, then I have a precise sandboxing goal, which is to ensure that sandbox code can only access the API and nothing else. So now I enforce that using I can enforce that using a blacklist or a whitelist, but I prove the theorem that you have the desired property. So with respect to that property, we have a complete blacklist. But this is the classic blacklist versus whitelist thing. But I don't think it's a very big deal here, because you can also view everything that I did as a whitelist. So I say there is a whitelist of identifiers and property names that you can only access. And you can access nothing outside these things. Ben, did you have a question?
No, I mean, I guess I wanted to ask about motivation for using complex clusters as a way.
Yeah. Can I take that offline? I'm running a little short on time.
That's fine.
Okay, comparing with FPGS. So FPGS is Facebook's mechanism for sandboxing applications on Facebook profiles. It's a sublanguage of JavaScript. Third-party code is written in FPGS. You rewrite it at the server and then place these rewritten applications on the Facebook page. So what are the restrictions that FPGS enforces, at least with respect to hosting page isolation? It blacklists certain critical identifiers and property names. It enforces an IDX-like check on dynamically computed properties. And then it disallows with, eval, and function. So overall, our technique is similar to FPGS, which is not surprising. It's entirely inspired by FPGS. But it's systematically designed. Our IDX check is semantics preserving. We are overall more expressive than FPGS, so we don't disallow the with construct, for example. Our sandboxing mechanism is backed by a rigorous proof of correctness. So I would like to mention that this proof is carried out manually, so there might still be unknown bugs in the proof, but at least having a manual proof increases our confidence that our technique works correctly. While doing the proof, we came across several corner cases, and that led us to find four different exploitable vulnerabilities in FPGS. For each of them, we built an app that could maliciously reach the DOM. We reported the app to Facebook, along with a suitable fix, which was promptly accepted. One limitation of this entire line of work, as you pointed out, is that our guarantees only hold for JavaScript as standardized. Now, the existing browser implementations, the JavaScript there is sort of deviant from what's there in the standard. And so some of our theorems might break there. But the main takeaway point is that formal semantics are immensely useful for both designing and analyzing sandboxing mechanisms. So if you want a provable, correct sandboxing mechanism for, let's say, IE, then you can design a semantics that's compliant with IE's implementation of JavaScript, and then repeat this whole process and get a sandboxing mechanism that works for IE. So this is sort of proof of concept that once you have a formal semantics for the full language, you can design and also prove correctness of sandboxing mechanisms for enforcing hosting page isolation. Okay, so now we move to the second part of the talk, which is mediated access. Here we have two problems, the sandbox design problem and the API confinement problem. So I'll first tell you about ES5 strict and our sublanguage secure ECMAScript of it. I'll tell you about our sandboxing technique and confinement analysis technique. And then I'll cover an application, which is the Yahoo AdSafe DOM API. Before doing that, let me tell you a little bit about why enforcing mediated access is challenging for ES3. So ES3 is not lexically scoped. And we looked at that in the scope analysis slide, you know, just how a static scope analysis is so challenging for ES3. This ambiently available access to the global object. What that means is there are various constructs in ES3 that magically give you access to the global scope object. Closures are not a safe encapsulation mechanism in JavaScript, and especially in the various browser implementations. And the reason is most browser implementations support a caller property. What that means is if I call a function, that function can access its caller, which means it gets a pointer back into my activation record, completely ripping apart closures. So you don't have a safe information hiding mechanism in ES3. All the built-in state is mutable. So all these built-in objects that the native JavaScript environment provides can be overwritten. And then finally, there is this eval construct. So together, these five things make defensive programming and static analysis very challenging. And so designing and analyzing these mediating APIs is a complete nightmare. Now, fortunately, the ECMA committee released ES5 Strict. What ES5 Strict is, ES3 with the following restrictions. I don't want you to parse them. But the thing they buy you is lexical scoping, no ambient access to the global object, and closure-based encapsulation. So finally, we have a version of JavaScript that is lexically scoped and that has safe closures, thanks to the ECMA committee. Our sub-language SES, Secure ECMAScript, is ES5 Strict with two more restrictions. All built-in state must be immutable, and we only allow a restricted form of eval, which we call scope-bounded eval. With these two things, we get rid of all the five problems that I've pointed out in ES3. I'll explain what scope-bounded eval is, but before that, I'd like to remark that SES is practical to implement within a browser supporting ES5 Strict, and it's currently under proposal by the ECMA committee for adoption in future versions of JavaScript. So what is scope-bounded eval? Now, eval is a construct that takes in string and executes that code. Scope-bounded eval is a restricted form of eval where I say it's the same thing, but you explicitly list all the free variables that you will access. So if you want to do eval function return x, the variable x here is free. And so you should explicitly list it at the call site. The runtime restriction is that when I'm evaluating eval, I will parse the argument, I will look at what free variables it has, and these free variables should be a subset of what you statically declared in your call. Now, the reason this is useful is because it allows for establishing an upper bound on the side effects that eval can cause. So imagine you're doing static analysis of a piece of JavaScript code, and you come across an eval statement. Earlier, this is a complete black box. I don't know statically what's going to run inside. Now, I at least know what variables you're going to touch, so I can establish some upper bound on what you're going to do. We developed a small step operational semantics for SES, and we formally showed that SES is lexically scoped. In particular, we prove a theorem that alpha renaming of bound variables is semantics preserving. Okay. So now let's go to the sandbox design problem, which is to ensure that sandbox code obtains access to any protected resource only via the API. Now, since SES is lexically scoped, this problem is actually very simple. Think of the API as an object, and the API methods are like methods of this object. So let's store this object in a variable called little API. And let's restrict untrusted code so that little API is the only free variable that it can access. And how do I impose this check? I can impose it using the scope-bounded eval. So eval is my friend now. I take third-party code, and I just place it in a scope-bounded eval context where I mark API as the only free variable. So now I'm guaranteed that this code can only access that free variable, and that free variable only holds the API. So I solve the sandbox design problem. And this is much simpler than all our previous sandboxing solutions. Okay, so now let's move to this API confinement problem. Verify that sandbox code cannot use the API to obtain direct reference to a resource that it's trying to protect. So what does confinement mean? Let's try to understand this better. On the left-hand side here, we have all our resources listed out as a graph. And suppose there's a star object, which is, let's say, the location object, which is a critical object that I never want untrusted code to have access to. I provide untrusted code with an API, which is just, let's say, just one method called F1. Now, I want to say that anything that you can do with F1, you can, regardless of what you do with this API method F1, you can never obtain access to the star object. So what all can untrusted code do with this API method? It can invoke it. That might give it access to some internal reference, let's say R2. Then you can go and crawl all the properties of R2 and then collect more objects, let's say R3 and R4. Then you go and side effect R4. And you can make it point to your own object. Now, the internal resource structure has changed, and so the semantics of this function F1 might have changed. And so you invoke it again, and you might get hold of more objects. And then you repeat this entire process to a fixed point. And at fixed point, this bag of things that you have collected, if it does not have a critical object, then you say that the API safely confines security critical resources. And if it has a critical object, then you say that the API leaks out the critical object. Now, this is just one API method. And in general, you can have an interleaving of multiple API methods. And so you can imagine that there's a precision efficiency trade-off here. However, we are not interested in any API. What we are interested in are these security critical wrapper APIs that are typically part of the trusted code base. They are small in size relative to the application, and the developer has an incentive of keeping the code simple. So the insight is that conservative and scalable static analysis techniques can do well here and soundly establish API confinement. You might be thinking these techniques have a lot of false positives, but we sort of think of the false positives as advantages, as they can be used for keeping a check on developers from using complex coding patterns. So I'm imagining sort of this confinement analysis tool as part of an IDE that you just run as a type checker in order to make sure that this API implementation is not leaking out critical references. Okay, so now let's try to set up this confinement problem. We want to define a predicate confined that takes an API implementation and a set of critical resources. So this is the code that executes in the system. P is the trusted API implementation that stores the API object in a variable little API that is sequentially composed with the sandboxed untrusted code, which is untrusted code S in a scope-bounded eval context that gives it access to the free variable API. For the sake of this problem, I also give you access to a variable test, and test is a challenge variable. So I say untrusted code wins if during the execution of this program, you can make this test variable point to anything critical. Right? So this reduces our confinement predicate to a points to analysis problem. So now I say, for all untrusted terms S, if the points to set of the variable test in the execution of this code does not intersect with anything critical, then the API safely confines critical objects. Now there are two hurdles here. One is this universal quantification over untrusted code. And then the second hurdle is how do we analyze eval? We get rid of both these hurdles by carrying out a flow insensitive and a context insensitive analysis. So flow insensitive means we are indifferent to the ordering of statements in a program. So for us, this program is basically a set of statements. Context insensitive means in our analysis, we only define a single activation record for every function. And so all calls, different calls to the same function flow into the same activation record. We analyze eval by abstracting an eval statement by the set of all statements you can write using the free variables. So observe that the abstraction is independent of the third-party code argument. You know, regardless of what the argument is, the abstraction is the set of all statements that you can write using the free variables. The reason we say set of all statements is because our analysis is flow insensitive. So actually, flow insensitivity is key here in getting a finite abstraction for eval. So this is an overview of our decision procedure. It's implemented in data log. So we abstract the trusted API implementation into a set of data log facts. We abstract the eval statement into data log facts. We abstract the SES semantics as inference rules, send these to a data log solver, churn it to a fixed point. And at fixed point, we check if the variable test points to anything critical. If it does, then we say that the API is not confined. Otherwise, we say that the API is confined. This technique of abstracting programs into data log facts is quite standard. It was originally, as to my knowledge, invented by John Bailey in his work. But it's subsequently been used by many other points to analysis techniques. So the idea is very simple. For every statement in the program, we have a specific predicate in data log. So here, if you have var y is equal to an empty object, then I have a data log fact which says stack y l1, which means y points to an object that was created at program label l1. If I see x equal to y, then I record a fact assign xy. Similarly, the semantics of SES can be abstracted as data log inference rules. So if I have assign xy and if y points to l on the stack, then x points to l on the stack. So programs can be abstracted as sets of data log facts, and execution of a program can be soundly abstracted as the least fixed point of these facts under the inference rules. So this is a standard abstract interpretation framework. You can think of the data log facts forming the abstract domain, the set of data log facts forming the abstract domain. These are all the data log predicates that we use, and these are sufficient to model implicit type conversions, reflection, exceptions, setters and getters. They cover all of JavaScript. So we prove a soundness theorem for our decision procedure, which is that if the procedure returns confined, then the API is actually confined. We implemented this procedure in the form of an automated tool called ncap, which is built on top of the BDDB data log engine. And the tool is available online. using this tool, we analyze the Yahoo AdSafe API. So what is Yahoo AdSafe? It's Yahoo's mechanism for sandboxing advertisements. It's in this API plus language-based sandboxing paradigm. So there's the Yahoo AdSafe API that provides restricted access to DOM objects. And then the sandbox is a JSLint filter that Yahoo defines. In this analysis, we ignore the Yahoo sandbox. Let's analyze the AdSafe API against the SES sandbox that we have. And let's try to prove that this AdSafe API safely confines DOM objects against SES code. And this can be done using our tool NCAP. So we annotated the API implementation, which is about 2,000 lines of code, and we desugared it to SES. Now, these annotations are basically type annotations that we add to the code. They are trusted, and they're basically added to improve the precision of our analysis. The first time we ran NCAP, we obtained not confined. And on zooming down, we found that if the methods go and lib were exposed on the API, then the tool says not confined. Now, we only have a soundness theorem for the proof, for the tool. So this could very well have been a false positive. But in this case, we got lucky, and this turned out to be a true positive. And on analyzing the go and lib methods, we were able to construct an exploit using which you can reach a DOM object. Now, this is interesting because AdSafe has been subjected to manual analysis previously, and none of them sort of spotted this bug. The way the tool helped us is that it helped us zoom down to these two methods. And so by staring at these two methods for a long time, we were able to construct this exploit. We fixed this bug. I'll take this after the slide. We fixed this bug, we ran NCAP again, and this time we obtained confined. So the main result that we have is that the AdSafe API safely confines DOM objects under the SES threat model, assuming that our annotations hold.
Is 2,000 line of code, you mean 2,000 line of code of annotation, or the all API implementation?
The API implementation is 2,000 line of code.
And what kind of code? What language?
JavaScript.
Yes.
How many annotations?
Oh, the annotations are only inside for loops. So if you have a for loop and you're accessing an array index I, let's say, so you have a box I. So I know that I is a number because it's the loop index. So I mark it as a number because my analysis is very imprecise on dynamic property lookups. Whenever you're looking up a property which is dynamically generated, I assume that it could be any property of the object. Now inside for loops, if I see the loop index I, then I know that this index is only a numeric property. So I mark that so that I can factor out this search. I can curtail my search space.
So a related question. You said about it could have been a false positive, et cetera. So were there false positives? Where it says
yes,
you
know, and that is why the annotations were added.
Right, I was going to say. So how strenuous was that process? How many times did you have to add more annotations to get rid of the false positive?
Oh, not too many. I think so. I think what annotations to add was the critical thing. So I stared at what kind of bugs were being found, and then I looked at all the IDB facts that were generated by the data log engine, and I figured out that it's sort of being very imprecise on these dynamic property lookups. And so I added an annotation that for inside for loops, wherever you had a dynamic property lookup, I added a numeric annotation. And after that, it sort of worked correctly. But it's also partly, the AdSafe API implementation is very disciplined. It's written by Doug Crockford, who's a security expert. And this is a very neat piece of code. It's sort of almost written with a type system in mind, although there are no explicit type annotations. But I think that's sort of the right target for a tool like this. It's meant for these security critical APIs, you know, that are responsible for enforcing isolation on third-party code. Okay.
So how many results did it yield? So other than those two culprits, are there any, did it admit a lot of suspects? This kind of follow-up question.
So the way we found those two culprits is by doing a greedy strategy. So we kept on removing methods from the API until this bug disappeared. And then we found that if you have go and lib, then you always, the API, the tool always says not confined. Yeah, so those two were the suspects.
So have they removed those methods subsequently, or was it the goal?
No, so then what they did is they added a runtime check. The trick is you can use the lib method to add a property to an internal object that you can then trigger using the go method. So now what they did is they modified the lib method so that you can't add properties of certain names. You can't add a property with a blacklisted name.
Right, but you're not close sensitive, not to mention pass sensitive.
Yes, so we handled that using an annotation. So we added an annotation there that this is non-blacklisted property, and then we could prove correctness. So that's why I say all our results are subject to our annotations being correct. Yes. So concluding remarks, there are 5 key security issues with ES3. Lack of lexical scoping, lack of closure-based encapsulation, ambient access to the global object, mutable built-ins, and eval. All ES3 sandboxing mechanisms are essentially trying to combat these 5 issues. And all the complexity there is because of these 5 issues. ES3 gets rid of the first 3 issues. SES gets rid of all 5. And it's currently under proposal with the ECMA committee. And I also believe that we are close to something which is both a usable and analyzable subset of JavaScript. The reason I think it is usable is because we were able to desugar this AdSafe implementation to SES. Now, AdSafe was implemented independent of the SES restrictions. And so this is probably a hint that well-intentioned programmers are already sort of following the restrictions in SES as best practices. And so we could get a tool that at least these well-intentioned program, we could get some language of JavaScript that at least these well-intentioned programmers like. API plus language-based, can I take it after the slide, please? API plus language-based sandboxing is a promising approach for enforcing fine-grained access control. The sandbox only needs to be designed once. Policies can be varied by modifying the API. And security is established only by analyzing the trusted API implementation and the trusted sandbox implementation. I never, in the solution for mediated access, I never look at untrusted code at all. So the solution works sort of for all untrusted code, and hence the universal quantification on untrusted code. The property that's out of scope for this mechanism is information flow control. So if you want to do information flow control, you have to actually look at the untrusted code. And that's a much harder problem. There's a whole bunch of related work on this topic. The closest work in the semantic space is LambdaJS, which is work by Sriram Krishnamurthy and Arjun Guha at Brown University. They define a core calculus for JavaScript, and they give a semantics to this core calculus. And then there is a desugaring function from the surface language to the core calculus. As a result, they end up with a much more manageable semantics. But anytime if you have a property about the surface language, you have to translate that into the core calculus. So it's a different style than our approach. There's work by Ben Lipschitz, which is Gatekeeper, very similar points to analysis. And many of the things we did here are sort of motivated by Gatekeeper. It doesn't do a confinement analysis, though. Language-based sandboxing has a long history with notable work like proof-carrying code, inline runtime monitoring, software fault isolation. So this tech, all our ideas are sort of inspired from this work. And as I said before, the main challenge is in applying them to JavaScript. And finally, in the browser space, you have browser-based sandboxing mechanisms that are also improving. So there's content security policy by Firefox that lets you restrict what scripts can run on the page. There's the sandboxed iframe that allows you to enforce fine-grained checks on what code can run inside iframes. And so browser-based techniques are also now quite capable of enforcing fine-grained access control and enforcing policies of the kind we are interested in. So what next on this topic? Last 4 years, standardized JavaScript has been evolving, and we know how to enforce fine-grained access control. Defensive programming is becoming easier, static analysis is feasible. Also, web applications are getting more and more privilege-rich. Now, with HTML5, web applications have access to geolocation, fancy audio-video APIs, local storage, cross-domain XHR, and so on. So in the future, let's move to the next policy now, which is information flow control. So questions like, does this app flow information from geolocation to the internet? Now, these questions were important even back in 2008. But back then, we didn't even know how to do access control correctly. And so now that we have a handle over access control, let's move to the next policy, which is information flow control. There are 2 building blocks that are needed: program analysis techniques for JavaScript and specifications for browser APIs. So we need better flow analysis and symbolic execution frameworks for JavaScript, type systems for confinement analysis, all the technology that's been developed for other languages like Java in order to solve a similar problem there. My recommendation would be to start with SES and then gradually move to arbitrary ES5 and ES3. SES is sort of more amenable to formal analysis than some of these others. we need specifications for the browser API. So anytime you're analyzing applications, these applications are essentially clients to browser APIs. So you need specs for them in order to do any information flow analysis here. Now, these APIs basically come with an implementation, a test suite, and English documentation. And building specs from the English documentation is both tedious and error-prone. This is actually a problem for all the application platforms that are out there. So if you want to reason about Windows 8 applications, you need specs for the Windows 8 SDK. If you want to reason about Android applications, you need specs for the Android SDK and the iOS SDK and so on. So in the future, I would like to work on automatically mining specifications for platform SDKs. So I want to start with very core specification problems. You know, what global state gets side effected when I call this method? What flows occur between the arguments and the return value when I call this method? You know, even answers to these basic questions can be better than having nothing. And I think we have the technology for answering questions like this. We have dynamic symbolic execution, dynamic type inference, invariant mining. And I think all these techniques put together can help us build code screen specifications for these things, which I think is very important to do any sound reasoning of applications. All reasoning that I see today either ignores the APIs, in which case they are unsound, or they make worst-case assumptions about the API, in which case they have lots of false positives. So having specifications would really help. Okay. So can I take 5 minutes to tell you about some of the other research that I've done? Okay. So this is completely different from security. We switch gears here now. This is about the two other projects. One is on safety and stability verification of hybrid systems. That's work I did with Ashish Tiwari and Sumit Gulwani. And then there's automated synthesis of processor instruction encodings. That is work that I did with Patrice. So I'll tell you about this project first. So what are hybrid systems? Hybrid systems are systems with both continuous and discrete dynamics. So these are systems that have multiple modes. Each mode has a differential equation that governs the dynamics in that mode. And there's a discrete switching logic across modes. Now, we are interested in safety and stability properties of these systems. So you can, the classic example would be a thermostat. So there's an on and an off mode. There's a differential equation governing how temperature varies in the on mode. There's a differential equation governing how temperature varies in the off mode. And then there's a switching logic. So the differential equations are modeled by dx by dt equal to fi of x, which is where fi is a field in mode I. And the switching logic is modeled by having these sets gij of x. So which means if the predicate gij of x is true, then it's OK to switch from mode I to mode j. So let's look at the thermostat example. So suppose I have two modes, on and off. In both these modes, the temperature increases and decreases at a constant rate, respectively. Let's say the switching logic is it's OK to switch from on to off if the temperature goes above 75, and it's OK to switch from off to on if the temperature goes below 65. So this is one possible trajectory of the system. You know, I start with 70 Fahrenheit, which is the initial state. Then I go up, then I do a switch, then I go into the off mode, and then I do a switch again, and so on. And there are multiple trajectories possible depending on how I switch. Now the safety problem here is I want to show that the temperature always stays between 60 and 80 Fahrenheit. Or I might have a stability question, that you always hit 72 Fahrenheit infinitely often. So this is a GF property. You know, there always exists a future where I will hit 72 Fahrenheit. So we want to solve these two problems. We want to verify safety and stability for polynomial hybrid systems. Polynomial hybrid systems are ones where all vector fields are polynomials and all involved sets are semi-algebraic. And we want to develop deductive verification techniques for analyzing these properties. So we prove safety by exhibiting an inductive invariant, and we prove stability by exhibiting an inductive Lyapunov function. So let me tell you a little bit about how we do the safety, how we analyze safety. Let's say there is only one mode. So there is a single mode. There's an initial state, and there's a differential equation governing how my state flows in this mode. And let's say the differential equation is dx by dt equal to f of x. So I want to show that this system always stays within a safe set. The way you do that is by finding an inductive invariant, which has the property is that the initial state is inside the invariant is inside the safe set, and if you're in the invariant now, then you're in the invariant at the next state. If you can find such an invariant, then you can prove safety. That's the classic deductive technique for verifying safety. Now, one challenge here is this find an invariant, which is a second-order existential quantification. So in order to tackle that, we use a template. So I can say, you know, let's fix the shape of invariance that we are looking for. And let the invariant be of the shape tc, x greater than or equal to 0, where c is an unknown coefficient. So now the problem reduces to, does there exist coefficients such that the invariant tc, x satisfies these three properties? The more subtle issue is this next state, which is the inductiveness property. Now, in discrete systems, I have a notion of next state. But what is the notion of next state in a continuous system? So in order to model the inductiveness property, we say that at all points on the boundary of this inductive set, so this invariant that we have is a closed set. So you can talk about its boundary, and we want to say that at all points on the boundary, the vector field actually points inwards. So anytime you hit the boundary, the field is actually pushing you back in. So now how do we check that a vector field points inwards at the boundary? One check is saying the gradient at the boundary, dot product with the vector field should be strictly greater than 0. But this is actually incomplete because it doesn't take care of fields that are tangential on the boundary. Then you can say grad t, so the gradient at the boundary dot the vector field is greater than or equal to 0. But unfortunately, this is unsound because of a degeneracy. So we worked very hard on this problem for multiple months in order to come up with a sound and complete procedure for checking inwards. And what we could come up with is a relatively complete check for the class of convex invariants. So this is work that got published at FSTDCS. We also worked on the safety problem for multiple modes and the stability problem for multiple modes. So stability can be verified by similarly exhibiting an inductive Lyapunov function. And I'll just take the question. And these are the references that we have on this work. Yes.
So you said relatively complete. Relative to what?
Relative to the class of all polynomial systems. So if you can prove, so if the system can be proved, the baseline is systems that can be proved safe with polynomial invariants. Mm-hmm. Now we can prove a system safe if it can be proven with a convex and polynomial invariant. The third project is that I worked on is automatic synthesis of processor instruction encodings. This is work I did with Patrice. So what is symbolic execution? Symbolic execution is the process of executing code with symbolic values rather than concrete values. So Sage is a tool that carries out symbolic execution of assembly code. So for example, you want to carry out symbolic execution of this code here. Then you need to know the meaning of every instruction symbolically. You know, what does shift left mean on two symbolic inputs? What is the symbolic formula for shift left? Now, one way to construct the symbolic encodings is by looking at the architecture specification, and you can sort of build the specification by hand. Now, this process is tedious. The specification is like 6,000 lines of code, at least the Intel x86 specification is. It's error-prone. It's difficult to translate English into formal logic. It's incomplete because a lot of things in the specification may often be underspecified. And it's also buggy because the specification may not correctly mimic the semantics of the processor. So in this work, we take a radical approach that can we synthesize these specifications automatically. So we have a black box processor. It takes in some instruction. There are some inputs and there are some outputs. These inputs are bit vectors. Given a processor and an instruction name, can we automatically describe the input-output relation corresponding to the instruction? This is the problem we want to solve. And the way we do that is as follows. So we first sample the processor on certain inputs, and we build a partial truth table. Then we hand this truth table to a synthesis engine, which searches for a function that respects at least that truth table. Then this function is sent to a validation engine that checks it on other inputs. And then all inputs that fail are sent back to the synthesis engine, where they are added to the truth table, and this process is repeated until the validation succeeds. And this validation is actually the tricky bit. And we have lots of ways of tackling this in so that we obtain functions for which we can say with very high confidence that they correctly mimic the processor. We use this technique to automatically synthesize encodings for all the ALU instructions. So we, in total, came up with 512 encodings for all the outputs, E flags, 8, 16, and 32 bits. And this work has been recently accepted at PLDI. All right, so these are all my collaborators. Huge thanks to them, and a huge thanks to you for listening to me for this long. Thank you.
Are there any other questions?
So at the beginning of the talk, you said this was
necessary as compared to iframes, because iframes restricted you to part of the screen, right?
Yeah.
But you didn't say how you would restrict access to the screen. It's sort of an open problem that anyone who's implementing one of these APIs has to decide how they're going to let their constrained code access the DOM or access the screen.
Yes.
And that just seems really dangerous to me. Right now, now everyone has to. You sort of push that problem onto the engineers, and that seems like so.
Yeah.
So now we've gotten rid of the problems of how do you properly constrain the sandbox. Now it's how do you properly give the sandbox access to just the right things so it can only draw on just the right part.
Yeah. So this is so you always have both the ways. You can go you can do the language-based sandboxing thing, or you can use browser primitives. Now, one browser primitive that I have in mind that could really help is this embed ads primitive. So for example, ads is like a common case of third-party content in all web pages today. And so one could imagine that we have a fixed security policy that we want to enforce on the ads. So there's like a fixed API. And this the browser can do for us. So for example, one technique could be to have an embed ads frame wherein you can put in the scripts from the ad networks. And the embed ad frame provides access to a limited portion of the DOM of the hosting page, the portion of the DOM that these scripts need access to. So I've been looking at some of the scripts from the Yahoo ad network and trying to understand, you know, what code does it load dynamically and what part of the DOM does it access. And so one of the things I observed is that the Yahoo ad network scripts scrape first 5,000 characters of your source completely. Now, this may or may not be acceptable to the hosting page. And so this is where the browsers can sort of come in and sort of establish one policy for ads. You know, ads have access to only this portion of the DOM and these particular fields. And you can have a little bit of customization there where I can provide special objects to this ad frame, wherein basically to have more targeted ads. But browser-based solutions can do better there. For other cases where I have more specialized third-party code, which is specific to my application, I might need an application-specific policy that I would like to enforce. And there, this API plus language-based sandboxing technique can help.
The iframe, the sandbox iframe, right now, actually, that's already been deployed in some of the browsers. Pretty much, it can be leveraged for ads.
Oh, yeah. That's why I said now we know how to do access control. And the browsers are also now, we can also use browser-based solutions for doing access control. And so it's time to use design language-based techniques for.
Do you need an embed ad in that scenario?
Oh, the last time I looked at sandboxed iframes is you can enforce policies like whether you have script access or whether you have form access or not. But it was still not too fine-grained. Those were still coarse-grained policies. So if I provided with script access, I also wanted And then I can say whether it's same origin or non-same origin. So either it has complete script access to me or it has no script access to me. But I want to say you can only access scripts in my origin, but only part of only this portion of my DOM. Or I hand you over these objects and you can only directly script these objects and nothing else.
So some of your techniques, you know, that work on ES3 would work on pretty much any shipping browser. Others, on the other hand, require a more modern browser. What's your take going forward on whether we should, as researchers, target like the latest and greatest version of IE or Chrome or whatever versus legacy?
Oh, as researchers, we should target the latest and greatest version. That's one of the advantages we have as researchers. So here's the thing. If you're designing static analysis techniques for very strong guarantees, then languages like SES are more suitable. One, they will make your life easy. And secondly, I think it'll very rarely the case that you would want to have strong guarantees on ES3 code. Now, a person who cares about strong guarantees, if he has not moved from ES3 to ES5 strict, then I don't think he's going to use any of these fancy tools anyways. It's only for people who have moved from ES3 to ES5 strict in order to make their code more disciplined and leverage the cleaner semantics of ES5 strict. They are most likely to use tools that we are building here. And so that's why I said starting off with SES is the right step. We can have good tooling for SES, And that can also serve as motivation for people to migrate from ES3 to languages like SES. Yes?
When you're referring to moving to ES5 strict, does it apply to the hosting page, or could I have a hosting page in ES3 and just the embedded ads required?
No, the reverse, I would say. You should have the hosting page in SES, and the ads can be in ES3. So this is like the way people tackle typed and untyped code. The analogy is you have a typed hosting page, but it is robust enough to handle untyped or indisciplined code. And so one can imagine, so here, the AdSafe API implementation is in SES. And then you have this sandbox that takes in ES3, massages it out, makes it safe to use against SES. Now with SES, because it's in SES, it's amenable to static analysis and we can have strong guarantees. And then our sandbox can ensure that third-party ES3 code does not have too much power that it can break some of the SES semantic restrictions. Yes?
So you never talked about the overhead of enforcing these sandboxes. Is your sandbox particularly more costly in terms of...
So the second sandbox that I showed you, which is displacing third-party code into a scope-bounded eval context, is very lightweight because I don't do any rewriting at all. So that's just directly bringing in untrusted code. It's in SES, but which is just, it should be written in SES. And I have the guarantee about my API for all SES code. The first sandbox does involve rewriting, but our rewriting is no more than what FPGS just performs. And so our performance is comparable to FPGS.
Where you cannot have dynamic code generation.
Yes.
Is that depending on the application?
Yeah, that is a function. Yes. But FPGS also doesn't support eval.
Right.
And if you think that is sort of, there is a developer community that develops apps in FPGS, so at least that community would like.
Do you think actually the Facebook application developers would like to use eval or dynamic code generation? Or is it because in that scenario, the Facebook sacrificing functionality for security?
Oh, so that's sort of an empirical question. There's Jan Wittek's study in PLDI 2009 on JavaScript code in the wild, and he found that a fair amount of JavaScript code in the wild uses eval. He also found that the most common use of eval is for deserializing and serializing JSON. And actually, for that kind of eval, the scope-bounded eval is actually useful, because for those eval contexts, they're not really touching free variables. And so you can sort of mark, you can have empty free variables, and we can have some handle on them.
How about document.write?
Sorry?
How about document.write? Does that work observe a wide usage of that?
Yeah, so document.write has to be restricted in this mediated access policy that we have. You're asking, does the work deal with document.write? I think it buckets let me remember. It does study document.write, but I can't remember what were the main points that it made about it. But in this work, actually, you have to limit document.write or you have to tame it. So it's critical to tame all channels in which you can dynamically bring code into the system. And this is why these techniques are sort of in conflict with ads. So I was basically looking at all these ad network code to understand, what sandboxing is done in the real world. And they do nothing. They just embed scripts directly in the page, and everything is on trust. And these ad network codes actually fetch, the chain to get to the real ad is very long. And so I embed code from Yahoo, but then Yahoo will go to various ad agencies, it'll go to DoubleClick, it'll go to click tracking companies and embed code from there, and I may not trust those. My understanding is why they don't use these kind of sandboxing mechanisms is that they heavily rely on dynamic code generation, dynamically fetching new code into the system. And these techniques are sort of, They dislike dynamic code generation to begin with, because they want to have a handle of what code comes into the system. And so that's why I think for ads, a browser-based mechanism might do well.
Are any of these techniques useful for restricting third-party tracking?
So third-party tracking, let me think. If you have third-party tracking code that is trying to sniff content from your hosting page, then these techniques are useful. So
generally, that's not the problem.
Yeah. So other kinds of third-party tracking is you're basically sharing stuff at the server. You have this third-party code that is on multiple pages, and you have the same cookie. And that cannot be blocked here. So you can do third-party tracking even if you place discontent in an iframe. And it's on this cookie mechanism, which is sort of orthogonal to here. You know, even if this script, if I say that,
what if there is no cookie? What if you prohibit the cookie setting? You can still do some form of tracking.
Yeah, using if it contacts the server. Let's say I can bring in this third-party content and I don't let it talk to the server at all. Then I can eliminate tracking. But if it talks to the server, either by a GET request or a POST request, it will get hold of the referrer, and then it can use that to do tracking.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.